thank you for having me here today to do a little speech. I believe I'm the only person who will be finished by a loud boom from outside. Hopefully I will feel this so I will know when to shut up. I'm Paul, I'm deaf myself, as you've probably picked up. I play the piano, play the organ, and without my hearing aid, hear nothing, and have spent most of my career as a musician. And in 1988, I decided to set up a charity based in Huddersfield called Music and the Deaf to help deaf people get involved in music. And over the years, I had both met and read about various famous practitioners over in America. So I was very, very grateful to be given the Churchill Fellowship in 1992 to go and find things out for myself. Here in the UK, music in schools was always used as a means to an end to develop speech and language skills in those days when sign language was banned. But over in America and in Canada, particularly in the 60s and the early 70s, there was an enormous amount of literature about music with and for deaf people, which I devoured enthusiastically in my younger days. But towards the mid-70s, things seemed to fizzle out, and the emphasis seemed to move back to the UK, where with the introduction of national curriculum, all deaf children had a right to a music education, but very few of them actually got it. So, 1992, I turned up in America, and on my second night there, was woken up by an earthquake. I originally thought it was perhaps my vibrating alarm clock, but it wasn't. And I was, at that point in California, speaking at a conference, which is actually an oral-based deaf organization. And there was a lot of enthusiasm there about music for deaf people in general, but particularly for therapy. From California, I went to Denver just for a few days' break, and I was amazed to find loads of deaf people all over the place. There was a very, very powerful deaf lobby conference going on. And it was from the first occasion I came across what I thought was real discrimination among deaf people for being involved in music. There was a Miss Deaf America pageant. I did not enter that, okay? But one of the winners from one of the states involved actually told the audience that music was her hobby and she played the piano. And there was a massive debate in the conference because they said, no, deaf people cannot possibly be musicians. There is no way you can be deaf and actually say you make music. It was a massive row about it. But it was a fascinating introduction to the polarization, if you like, of music among deaf communities in America. At the time, the Americans with Disabilities Act had just been introduced, but it hadn't yet really filtered down that much into music and arts education from what I saw. There were several places which made me realize there were massive differences between America and over here. Some of them quite amusing, some of them quite strange, because in complete contradiction to what I believe. One of the most interesting things was when I was in Washington and in Baltimore, finding out about music technology with deaf people. Now, for most deaf people, myself included, music technology is really difficult because you don't have that tactile sensation. You can press a key down on a keyboard, but you don't feel anything back. There have been numerous occasions in my life I've been playing electric keyboards and not even realized the switch off, which is probably why it sounds better. But there was a lot of prototype music technology going on in America at that time. Some of the ideas I brought back over here, tried to show them to various people, see if they could create things, but that never happened. There was an experience when I was working with the National Theatre for the Deaf in Chester in Connecticut, which was recommended to me by Richard Stilgo, because I wanted to find out about how they use music and sound effects in their drama production. And the short answer going all that way was, we don't use anything at all because it's a waste of time and it's quite pointless. I thought, no, it's not. But they seem to have this very fixed idea about what music could be and do. There was the amazing experience in St. Louis when I went to the theatre and there was an interpreter and I was told you can sit wherever you like but bring your own binoculars. They didn't have seats at the front. You had to sit anywhere you liked. The one exception, the place I really loved, was Rochester in upstate New York, where there was a wonderful guy called Bob working at an institute where they had a huge number of deaf musicians. They played in bands, they had wind bands, brass bands, rock bands, loads of individuals. And it was the one place I found where you had music being used very much for its own sake. Not for therapy, but for someone saying, this is music, I enjoy it, I appreciate it, and I want to share that with other people. I think that there are very few, but back then there were very few role models for deaf musicians in the USA. Perhaps the actual school system and the size of the country made that so. It was impossible to find young deaf musicians, or even older ones, who could stand up and say, I am deaf. This is what I passionately want to do and inspire other people. And it was so interesting to compare what happens in America with what happened here. I'd heard so much about the great things that happened, but on my return home, I actually realized there was a lot more going on here. I did learn a huge amount. It informed an awful lot of what I do and what I did for the next 20 years or so. And one thing that I would always say is that no deaf person will necessarily enjoy music. No individual will necessarily enjoy music. But they should all have an opportunity, at least once in their life, to at least try it and make that choice and decision for themselves. Music, as a friend of mine in London said several years ago, is not the prerogative of the hearing world. There are thousands and thousands of hearing people who don't enjoy music. But equally, there are thousands of deaf people who, despite their hearing loss, do enjoy. We found our own ways of doing it. Music among deaf communities is indeed alive and well. And several years down the line, I continue to use my experiences to inform, educate, and encourage what I do here in the UK. All thanks to the Winston Churchill Memorial Trust. Thank you so much.